As Germany unites, an old row about her land borders erupts. So will a new and powerful Germany once again threaten the stability of Europe? United and powerful, but it will still be linked to old and bitter memories. 45 years ago, Colonel Todd Sweeney was one of the first British soldiers to cross the Rhine into the German heartland. His objective was the station here at Hammenkeln.
Well, when we arrived here, our main effort was directed at killing the Germans and ending the war. I feel it's inevitable that there will be some reunification of some sort of the two Germanies, but I hope that it won't be rushed too much.
In the new Germany, politics are moving at breathtaking speed, with thousands of Easterners now demanding unity with the wealthy West. There are new revelations of how the communist nuclear reactor program wasted billions and still endangers much of Europe. There are right-wing extremists who reassert Germany's claims to the lands she lost in World War II. And there are the lonely voices from the past, fearing new dangers in the present.
We had slogans calling for the rebirth of Germany, awakening of Germany, together with the call to drive out Jews, which is a clear slogan of Germany in the 30s, Deutschland erwache, Jude verrecke.
In an East German city named after Karl Marx, the astonishing spectacle of thousands calling for the West German Chancellor Helmut Kohl. Kohl is campaigning for his party's allies in this month's East German elections with a simple call for unity.
Wir sind ein Volk.
The elections are supposed to be between East German parties. In fact, West Germany's political leaders have taken over. This week, Chancellor Kohl took steps to speed up still further the drive for unity. He appeared to brush aside calls for greater caution, calls led by Margaret Thatcher, who has said all along that she wants the process to be slowed.
You have to look at the facts. The people of East Germany are elbowing their way into freedom, which they have been missing for 40 years, and perhaps the Prime Minister should tell them that they should stay longer in prison. I don't think any responsible politician in the West can say that. You have 16 million people who have lived under dictatorship for 40 years, a red dictatorship, and before that a brown dictatorship, and they now want freedom at once. And I think the people in Great Britain will understand that we can't tell them you have to wait for another 10 years.
Well, I feel a bit pushed into to sign a contract where I haven't had the time to read its small print in advance.
Do you feel that you've simply been steamrolled by Chancellor Kohl?
Yeah, it's correct. Not by Chancellor Kohl, by the whole process, by that wrestling that's going on between the two superpowers in West Germany, SPD and the right wing, and they are doing here, there, they are campaigning their campaign, and it's sometimes ridiculous, I would say.
You are being effectively rolled over by the West German political machine.
That's right. That's what's going on.
What Mrs. Thatcher, as well as many others, perhaps failed to grasp was the sheer speed at which the East German edifice would crumble. Behind the Marxist facade, the communist state was politically and financially destitute. In a final attempt to gain time, the government here appealed to West Germany for financial aid, but Chancellor Kohl turned them down with what looked to many like contempt. The result is that the unification of the two Germanies is not a merger of equals, but the straightforward takeover of a failing and bankrupt concern. Only now are East Germans starting to learn what tragic mistakes were made in their country. Just across the North Sea from Britain, a £3 billion investment in nuclear power that succeeded only in endangering much of Europe. These reactors can produce more than 10% of East Germany's electricity, but they were built with the primitive Soviet technology that went so badly wrong at Chernobyl. The reactors have no reinforced domes to contain leaks. Leaks of radioactive steam are vented first through a simple chimney, and then, if the problem's serious, released through a trap door straight into the atmosphere.
Ansonsten weiter Betrieb mit der Anlage 1.
In the control rooms, operators work with a system that was already out of date when it was built. Under West German pressure, two of the four reactors are presently shut down for checks. It's believed there may be rust at the heart of the nuclear plants. In one of the reactors that's still running, the manager uses a cheap plastic intercom to communicate with other parts of the power station, because the reactor's telephone system can't be relied on in a fast-moving situation.
For one thing, some numbers are always engaged, or it's the telephones themselves. This new switchboard system doesn't always work. It makes my job a bit more difficult. You can't always get hold of people. But we have these radio pages so we can contact the most important people.
But the main problem is the fundamental design. The reactors depend for safety on a water cooling system. But in an emergency, there is only one backup supply. In Britain, there would be three. The turbines of all four reactors are grouped together, greatly increasing the risk of a serious fire. There are no automatic sprinklers. If fire breaks out, the workers are expected to douse it with a set of elderly hose pipes.
We know how stringent safety regulations are in Western power stations, and we're lagging a good way behind. The existing safety systems do work, and they're checked regularly, but they don't go far enough, especially in the event of leaks in the coolant system. The condition of the pipes is a source of concern. If we get a major loss of coolant accident, we won't be able to cope with it.
German unity is likely to mean the closure of this complex, including four more reactors presently being built. In the south of the once communist state, more evidence of how its economic system was heading for self-destruction. Desperate for growth, the communists boosted production in old-fashioned industries that have brought disaster to the environment. Lacking energy reserves, East Germany based its industry on low-quality brown coal, difficult and dirty to burn. This plant at Espenhain processes brown coal for the chemical industry. It was built by the Nazis to supply their war effort. Workers here endure conditions that are now unthinkable in Western Germany. For these men, German unity will mean the plant's closure and the hitherto unthinkable prospect of unemployment. But with the old system breaking down and bankrupt, unity still offers hope, a hope based on faith and history.
We are one German people. Deep in our hearts, we have always felt German. Deep down inside, we have never accepted or understood the separation imposed upon us under communist rule. People from the same town, even relatives, were split up. Now, we can bring out into the open what we thought all along, but were not allowed to say.
Downwind of the Espenhain plant is the village of Molbis, where you can taste the grit of coal dust in the air. Many of the young patients in a local doctor's waiting room are suffering from bronchial or skin complaints. Their plight is another reason why East Germans are looking to the West for help. This boy has eczema, probably caused by the pollution. Local people are now sending groups of children on trips to West Germany, simply so that they can breathe clean air for a few weeks.
We feel that it's a good idea to give the children an opportunity to breathe some good, clean air. Because, as pediatricians, we know that if their respiratory systems can be cleared of toxic substances, and they can breathe fresh air for a time, they will have a better chance of recovering from illnesses like bronchitis.
Chancellor Kohl's supporters say the flood of refugees is the reason why unity cannot be slowed.
Unless we bring freedom and welfare to the East Germans over there, they will all come here. So that's where the speed is coming from, and nobody can stop that. It's not an easy situation, but there's no recipe, I mean, to stop the refugees. So we have a very practical problem, 2,000 people coming here every day. In the last 2 months, we've had another 125,000 Germans coming from East Germany, and unless that is stopped, we will run into a chaos, and that is the real danger.
But there are a few in East Germany who see another danger altogether in the onrush of events. In East Berlin is a Jewish cemetery established by the community that existed here before the war. The cemetery survived the Holocaust intact and was then systematically vandalized in the supposedly denazified 1970s. Dr. Mario Offenberg lost much of his family in Hitler's attempt to exterminate the Jews. Regaining the cemetery from the state and then piecing together the damaged stones has become his personal mission. Now Dr. Offenberg fears that troubled times may lie ahead.
I think that everyone can be happy about the end of the Cold War and about the demilitarization and those developments, which are very positive. On the other hand, you may not ignore that the growing of German nationalism is always coming in history with danger for minorities, danger for the neighboring peoples, is bringing other very dangerous tendencies and making them, so to say, sociable or honorable, as you may see today. You have today slogans in the demonstrations in Berlin and in Leipzig that they are a clear expression of nationalism and of racialism.
There is still a small Jewish community in East Berlin, which meets in a former synagogue. In this room at least, the mass demonstrations calling for unity have left a feeling of unease.
We are thinking now in our community center about the need of putting a TV control camera outside of the building. And we didn't have in the past this feeling that we should, because we come every morning and we don't know if something happened to the house in the night, for instance, or to the windows or to the glasses.
On the far right of mainstream politics are the Republican Party and their leader, Franz Schonhuber. A former member of Hitler's SS, he puts across a carefully phrased nationalistic message that has won some support in southern Germany. Schonhuber expects to gain from German unity.
Nobody can stop it. This is the wish of the German population, of our friends, of our sisters and brothers in the other part of Germany. And I think Mrs. Thatcher, and I still said that I admire her very much, she should help us, because we are no danger for other countries.
In fact, it is Schonhuber's nationalistic attitude to one of Germany's neighbors that gives his raucous party a role in current events. The right-wingers who attend these sometimes violent meetings believe that Germany should reclaim the land it lost to Poland after World War II. On this question, the far right could win votes from Chancellor Kohl. A united Germany will be the largest nation in Central Europe, with the line of the Oder and Neisse rivers marking the eastern border with Poland. But before World War II, Germany's borders were much further to the east, with part of what is now northern Poland forming the province of East Prussia. These old areas are a source of nostalgia for some Germans who would like them back.
The substance is very clear, and politically it's 100% clear. The present border between East Germany and Poland will be the eastern border of a united Germany. The problem is that as a German politician you have to add that legally this can only be decided by an all-German parliament and an all-German government. But in substance, there's no doubt, and the Chancellor has said, there will be no change with regard to that border.
The trouble is that Schonhuber is at Kohl's shoulder, waiting to pick up votes. It's feared that he could yet embarrass a Christian Democrat government with the border issue, which the former SS man handles with his own brand of delicacy.
My personal feeling is this is a German soil.
And it is a pity that Poland lost a huge part of the territory in the east of Poland, stolen by the Russians. We want, I mean, this would be so silly to say, Poles go out. They have the right to live there, the same right have the Germans to live there. They should live together, and we will find a new solution.
It may, in the end, be a left-wing social democrat government that in fact has to find solutions to the problems of a united Germany. Willy Brandt, the retired chancellor and still his party's figurehead, is now campaigning vigorously in the East German elections, where his allies lead in the polls. Brandt's powerful endorsement of German unity has helped to make it inevitable. As the man who opened West Germany's doors to the East, he now seeks moderation on the border question.
I think an overwhelming majority of the German people would say, let's stop this treating Poland as if it were a state on wheels, being moved in one direction or the other. We have to live with a new borderline and then, as far as possible, to work in the direction of making borderlines easier to cross, as we have been able to do in the West. Why shouldn't this happen in the East as well?
But for now, there are still two Germanies. The vast crowds in the East buzz with expectation that the political caravans from the West will transform their lives. And the people here can now expect a massive injection of West German money. The West German politicians represent economic success. And the fusion that is taking place here is likely, in the end, to produce one economic superpower. But is the new nationalism surging in the East a source of danger for the future?
I'm old enough to remember that Germany did not become a problem because it was economically too prosperous. Huh? Hitler came to power because there was a deep crisis with millions of unemployed and whatnot. I think an economically strong Germany also could be, I hope, a good partner within the European community.
British military police still mount patrols in West Berlin, but the old order is coming to an end. Today, Helmut Kohl met his military allies in NATO to try to smooth Germany's path towards reunification. In this changing situation, it's reported that the British garrison may even leave Berlin this year, a move that might pave the way for this city to become once again the capital of a united Germany and a center of German power and influence. Berlin without the wall will be the heart of a country with the most powerful industrial base in the whole of Europe, dominating trade in both East and West. But given past grandeur, will economic power be enough? Or is this the birth of a Fourth Reich, a fourth period of imperial dreams and aspirations?
The Germans, are very cool in this historic situation. West Germany has become a very stable democracy. And so when you get 16 million new Democrats now, and the people in East Germany, they have suffered from two dictatorships almost in the last 60 years. I think this is an enrichment for all Europeans, and this is the way it should be considered, nothing to do with the Fourth Reich.
So Mrs. Thatcher's concerns are those of a past age. They have no relevance to the present.
Well, I can understand that people have a memory of the past, but I think look at the present generation in Germany, and look at the young Germans, and you will see a stable democracy. And it is very stable once our neighbors cooperate with us and don't mistrust us.
When I arrived here, it was absolutely littered with gliders. The gliders were flying in loose pairs, and then they were released over the Rhine. Mm. And then the glider pilots had that steeple there as their aiming point to give them some indication of where Hamelkeln was.
It is perhaps not surprising that those who survived the great battles of World War II find it difficult to trust completely. Colonel Sweeney wishes the new Germany well, but does not feel able to entirely forget the past.
I sincerely hope that the sacrifices which my comrades made on this very spot here, where 100 men from my battalion were killed in the space of half an hour, only 40 days before the end of the war, that those haven't been in vain. I don't think I feel that what is happening today means that that has been in vain, because one hopes that Germany is a sensible enough nation that she will not ever try to go to war against her neighbors again. But at the back of one's mind is the fact that this has happened twice before.
The elections now taking place in eastern Germany remain a triumph for democracy after decades of the Cold War. But only time will tell what real effect that triumph will have upon the future of Britain and of Europe.